I'm Tyler Suters, and you're watching Clean Skies News. This past weekend, the D.C. Environmental Film Festival wrapped up 2 weeks and 155 films and shorts on this single genre or single topic of environmental issues. Among them, Carbon Nation, a film about mitigating the effects of climate change. With us now is the co-producer and director of that film, Carbon Nation, Peter Bick. Peter, good to have you with us today.
Thank you, Tyler. Appreciate it.
I'd like to start off with a quote that you issued about this film itself. It's very simple, but it's also telling. We're not making a global warming film. We're making a global warming solutions film. And there is very much a difference here.
I think that Davis Guggenheim and Al Gore made the perfect global warming, there's a problem film. It got my attention. Mm-hmm. And so we made this film to go towards the solutions, and with no blame, no shame, moving forward, what's out there right now that's working, what could be working, what do we need to be doing? And so we didn't know if that stuff existed when we started the film 3 years ago. We hoped it did. And believe me, when you're making a film like this and you're delving into this deep a subject matter and this heavy a subject matter, there's many days of depression when you're finding out how many, if we went nuclear, how many nuclear plants would have to be built over the next 3 decades, one a week.
Depressing or sobering,
one of the two, I'm sure. Really intense. And like our first editor, Eric Driscoll, he almost left the film. It was almost too heavy until we started getting the solutions footage in. And then he was like, okay, cool. Like Bernie Carlin in Alaska, the crazy geothermal man.
Crazy applies to several of the characters I think you ran across. And I like the juxtaposition you have, Peter, between what you call ordinary Americans and also some of the power brokers. And we meet George Bravos, who's a long-haul trucker who uses battery power to heat and cool his cab. My favorite, though, is the one-armed Texas wind farmer Cliff Etheridge, a guy who's a former cotton farmer who sees real opportunity in the wind sector.
Yeah, Cliff. My wife, Krista Fensale, one of the producers, she found Cliff. And I heard there was wind going up in West Texas, and we were in El Paso for another story. And I said, well, find somebody, because we'll be in West Texas. That's when I learned that West Texas was actually from Dallas to El Paso. So we had a heck of a drive to get to Cliff that day. But Cliff, he saw these wind farms going up on giant ranches near him. He could see it from his house. But his area was a bunch of really small farms. And so he gathered 400 people, did all the legal work to get them as one unit, and got Aon Energy in to build the wind farm. So he actually created the world's largest wind farm. One cotton farmer with one arm. And he's a real character. I think he'll actually do more for this movement than just about anybody else.
You also, Peter, though, talked to the leaders of Duke Energy, Jim Rogers, of Exelon, John Rowe, Sir Richard Branson from the Virgin Empire. Yep. And I say simply because these are power brokers. These are decision makers, but they can be, on many occasions, far removed from what you call the front lines.
Yeah, no, they absolutely can. But I learned specific things. I learned about energy efficiency from both Rowe and from Jim Rogers. I was at the very first conference we were filming at was an ACEEE conference, and John Rowe was talking about wanting to get low-income housing better, to make them more energy efficient, because it's just all this waste, and it would create jobs. And I was just blown away that this titan was talking about something that down to earth. And Jim Rogers also was talking about, you know, if you save energy, that's much cheaper than building another power plant. And so I was learning a lot of stuff from these guys. And, you know, they're big guys, and they've got their stockholders and things like that. But they're cutting-edge people. And Branson, he's just his own guy. But he didn't know about climate change. He said that in the interview we had with him, he said Al Gore came to his house and gave him the pitch. And the light bulb went on, and he got it.
And Peter, final question. From an environmental film festival, I think that you as a viewer expect a big push for renewable energy. Solar, geothermal, wind, and those elements are certainly in your film.
Yep.
But you also take a hard look at their traditional sources, the fossil fuels, as well as nuclear energy.
Yep. Well, basically, you know, the clean coal movement is an advertising campaign. Coal is a dirty fuel, and that's what we discovered in our film, and there's some really interesting statistics about that. But also getting coal is very dirty. I live in Kentucky, and it's mountaintop removal is a tough thing right now. But coal's perfect because it's so freaking packed with energy. You know, we wouldn't be here. We wouldn't have any of this equipment if it wasn't for coal. So we've certainly built an amazing society on coal. But there's got to be a way to do it better now. And I think the best thing to do is we can make things so much more efficient so we won't need as much coal. Now, they're working on carbon sequestration, carbon capture and sequestration. It's far off. And I just, I don't know if it's going to work because it's so much carbon that has to be sequestered. I love the idea of concrete that sequesters carbon. We interviewed some people that will be on our website that are using carbon as a feedstock for plastic. So that's cool. With nuclear, we're still trying to figure it out as a film team. Mm-hmm. We say in the film that, you know, there's the positive side of nuclear, which is enormous amount of energy. The negative side is the proliferation potential of the waste. And no one knows what to do with the waste. Even France with 70% nuclear power and Japan with 90%, they still don't know what to do with the waste. They just shift it around a lot. And that's really the trick. But there's, you know, you hear things about people are learning how to reuse the waste. So it's just, we're pretty smart people. If we can just get smarter, I think it'll be a much better situation.
Peter Bick is co-producer and director of the film Carbon Nation, debuting here at the DC Environmental Film Festival. Peter, once again, thanks for being with us.
Thank you, Tyler.
And the next stop for the film is sometime in May. It's going to open in Peter's hometown of Louisville, Kentucky. I'm Tyler Suitors. Thanks for joining us here on Clean Skies News.